Shri Guru Pihon Maha, Srivan Venkatanathariya Kavita, Kikisari, Vedanta, Tachar, Kevin Yome, Sanir Hattam, Sadhardi, Jñāna, Nandamayam, Devam, Nirmalas, Patika, Katim, Adharam, Sarva Vidyana, Hayagrivam, Pas Mahe, Sheshavit Parishadeshu Natha, Vidagdha Goshti, Samarang, Ganeshu, Jikishatome, Kavita, Kikindran, Jikva, Grazimha, Sanamam Jipayaha, Yat Padam, Bhurudhyana, Vidhasta, Sheshakal Mashaha, Astutam, Payatuham, Yamuneyam, Namavitam. So as we are looking into the Bhagavad Gita, from the perspective of Sri Ramanuja, who was one of the important propagators of the Visistadvaita Vedanta school of thought, we are in the 12th verse of the second chapter. The 12th verse is Natve Vaham Jatunasam Natvam Neme Janadhipaha Nachevana Bhavishyamaha Sarve Vayamatah Param Natve Vaham Jatunasam Natvam Neme Janadhipaha Nachevana Bhavishyamaha Sarve Vayamatah Param. As we saw in the last week, this shloka has a double negative way of conveying. There are two negatives in this shloka. Usually, the usage of two negatives is not appreciated in the English language, as I found in the internet. It is not the best of usages if you use two negatives in a sentence. But in languages like Sanskrita and Tamil, the usage of a double negative in a sentence reinforces the meaning in a very positive manner, strong manner. So Krishna is beginning to give his discourse to Arjuna, saying, Natve Vaham Jatunasam. It is not that I did not exist before. It is not that you did not exist before, which means we both existed in the past. Also, Neme Janadipaha. Na Ime Janadipaha. Janadipaha means these kings who have assembled here to fight. So all these kings were also there before. Before in the sense, in their previous birth. And here, the usage of Tvam Aham, like you and I, it means the Atma which is inside and not the Sharira. Because now, what Krishna means is that we had previous births. We were living in the past. And he says, Nachevana Bhavishyamaha. So we will continue to live in the future as well. Life does not stop with this birth. Life is a continuous process. As long as the jivatmas or the individual cells do not attain the knowledge which is going to do away with the bondage, all the jivatmas will continue to exist in some form or other. That is what Krishna means here. So you will continue to exist and all these kings will continue to exist because the Atma is eternal. The soul, as we call in English, there is no equivalent meaning of Atma in any language because Atma is a sentence, it's not a word. Apnoti iti Atma, that which pervades, that which attains is Atma. So the English words like soul and self are not the real representations of the word Atma, but they do represent a portion. So the Atma is eternal, it does not have any death, whereas the Sharira has an end. That is what is going to say in the next verse as well. Nachevana Bhavishyamaha, it is not that we will not exist in the future, but we will exist. Sarve Vayamatah Param. So we will all exist in the future. We all existed in the past and we do exist now. Here I, you and we. I, you and we means the Atma. The Atma as associated with the Sharira. Now here Ramanuja makes an interesting argument that the teaching of the Bhagavad Gita is not Advaita but Visistadvaita. Because Krishna is using the pronouns like I, you and they or I, you and we. According to Advaita, There is only Brahman. There is only Atma. The entire world is an illusory appearance. The Jivatmas are also illusory appearances due to their ignorance. Once they are relieved of their ignorance, they will realize their non-difference with Brahman. This is Advaita. Advaita also accepts the existence of individual Atmas, but only up to a level. Beyond that level, when the knowledge arises, the world does not exist. The individual souls, as conditioned by a sharira, by a body, do not exist. It is only the Brahman which exists. This is Advaita. But Ramanuja argues that if Krishna were to teach Advaita, he would not have used pronouns like I, you and we. He must have said something like, only the Atma exists. You are that Atma, I am that Atma, don't worry. But he is saying very clearly, it is not that I did not exist, it is not that you did not exist, it is not that these kings did not exist. Which means, he is teaching difference or Bheda. In the Visistadvaita philosophy, the Jivatmas can never become the Paramatma. The Jivatmas are Jivatmas. They are always inferior to the Paramatma because the Paramatma is Vibhu. Vibhu means omnipresent. He is present everywhere. The Jivas have an Anuswarupa. Anuswarupa means an infinitesimally small Swarupa. So even after liberation, a Jivatma cannot become one with the Paramatma. He will continue to exist on his own. So this is the argument of Ramanuja, and he says very clearly that Krishna is making use of these pronouns to clearly say that there is Bheda between Paramatma and Jivatma. Now how about the Jivatmas? Are they all alike or are they all different from each other? Now all the Jivatmas are similar. They are not same, they are similar. They have a similar nature. The Swarupa of all the Jivatmas are similar. Yet they would continue to exist separately. Like we have the atoms of a compound. There are many atoms, but structurally or essentially all the atoms are the same nature. They have a nucleus, they have a and so on. So with some examples like this we can convey, but examples will not convey the complete understanding. They help us to appreciate a portion of the truth. So the point here is that Brahman is there and the Jivatmas are there, and the Jivatmas will continue to exist even after getting liberation. So this is Krishna's beginning of the teaching. So here Ramanuja says that he gives his philosophy here. Then how do you bring about a relation between Brahman, Atma and the world? Then Ramanuja says, Brahman is like the Atma to be the whole unit which is made of Brahman, Jiva and Jagat. As we see the world, we see the world to be a combination of both sentient and non-sentient principles. That is, sentient means life in a sense, those which are able to know their presence, those which are aware of their presence. Like we, as in the speaker and the listeners, we are all aware of our own presence. We don't need the help of someone to be aware of our presence. We are not going to ask someone, am I present or not? No. Even during deep sleep, the awareness is there, but it is overcome by tamas, that we do not know. So always the awareness about one's self is there in some beings. And there are some beings like the matter, all forms of matter, which are not aware of their own presence. Which means they do not have any jnana in them to be aware of themselves and to be aware of other things. If you see the world is a combination of these two. And we also see that the matter, even though they may act, they require some force to be acted upon. That is what even science says, even Newton says that. Any body continues to be in a state of rest or motion until an external force is going to act upon it. So it is a chetana, the force of a chetana or the will of a chetana is required to create a motion. So now this combination of both life and non-life is the entire world, and Brahman is the force which sustains this combination. So which means the Paramatma is the soul, is the Atma of this entire stuff, and the Jivatmas and the Jagat and the matter, they constitute the body, the Sharira of this universe. Which means it's like saying the universe is the Sharira of the Paramatma, of which he is the Atma, because he is going to sustain. As this Sharira is sustained by the Atma inside. Because once the Atma leaves, we know what happens to Sharira. It cannot stand anymore. It decomposes. It falls off. So we need a sentient principle to support. Now what is a Sharira now? Ramanuja gives a definition of Sharira. Yasya chetanasya yadravyam sarvatmana swarthe niyantum dharayitum cha shakyam tat cheshadeka swarupam cha tat tasya shariram. Yasya chetanasya yadravyam. Let me give the English equivalent, then we can appreciate it better. A body is that substance which an intelligent person in the sense the jivatma, or an atma to be general, a sentient being, in every way supports. So the body is something which the atma supports, controls and uses for its own purposes, and which exists only to serve him. Let us take the microscopic example of our own case. Now, when I use the pronoun I means Atma, I am able to control, I am able to support the Sharira, I am able to control it, and I am using it for my purposes. I can use it for good or bad, it's a different thing, but I use it for my own purposes. I want to go to hear the lecture, Gita lecture, then the body takes me there, because I command the body to go and the body goes and takes me there. If I want to go elsewhere, it will take me there. Which means I am able to support it, I am able to control it, and able to use for my own purpose. Now looking at the macroscopic level, the entire universe is existing for the purpose of Paramatma. But what we do is that we forget that we are part of a holistic mechanism, and we think that we are existing for our own purpose. And that is why we are ignorant and we get into a lot of problems. Like somebody working in an organization, in a company, what he has to do? He has to align himself to the policies, to the goals of the organization. If he is not going to do that, if he is going to work on his own, for his own purpose, you know what's going to happen to that person. He will be punished in the long run. So in a similar way, the entire world is a single unit of which Paramatma is a supporter, he is a controller, and this world is existing for his own purpose. That is why in this sense, the entire world, along which means a combination of both Chetana and Achetana, is a Sharira to the Paramatma. In the same way, this Sharira also holds good. The definition of Sharira also holds good in our case, because we are able to support it, we are able to control it, and we are able to use it for our purposes. Interestingly, even in English, we have this usage of the word body, the general body meeting. Even organizations will make use of this word body, which means not only one person, but it means a set of team, and you know. So there also we are able to extend the idea of the Sharira, of the body. So everything in the universe is in a way supported by the Paramatma, both the sentient beings and the non-sentient beings, and the Paramatma is the Atma of the entire setup. So Krishna is the Paramatma, and the people like us are the Jivatmas. Like I said before, in the Visistadvaita school of philosophy, the Jivatma cannot become Paramatma. He is always different from the Paramatma. Now, Vedanta Desika, he defines the word Paramatma. He says, Desha Kala Swarupa Anavachinna Vyaptihi. desha kala swarupa anavachinna vyaptihi. The Paramatma is all pervasive. He is omnipresent. He is present everywhere. It is not possible to say that he is not present anywhere. Like those of you who know the Nisimha Avatara, wherein Prahalada, the young boy, is being asked by his father, Hiranyakashipu is the father. He is asking Prahalada, his son, is your God present here? He is showing some places. Then Prahalada says, yes, he is here. Then finally he shows a stambha, a pillar. And then Prahalada says with conviction, yes, my Lord is here. Then Hiranyakashipu breaks open the pillar and the Lord manifests. So this story or this episode, it reinforces the idea that the Paramatma is existing everywhere. God is everywhere. He is immanent. He is present everywhere. There is no place in the universe that we can't say God does not exist here. He exists everywhere. So, desha kala swarupa anavachinna. Avachinna means conditioned or limited. Anavachinna means unlimited or not limited. Paramatma pada nirukti. So, one who pervades everywhere without being conditioned by space, time and form is Paramatma. Whereas the Jivatma is quite opposite to it. He is Anuswarupa. In the next shloka, in the next verse, Krishna gives a comparison as to how the Atma takes different bodies. He says, Dehine spin yatha dehe kaubaram yugvanam jara tatha dehantara praptihi dhiras tatrana muhyati. Dehinaha asmin yatha dehe kaumaram yuvanam jara tatha dehantara praptihi dhiraha tatra na muhyati. Muhyati means being disillusioned. Na muhyati means a dhira is not disillusioned. We will see who a dhira is. Dhira means we can say a brave person, but an intelligent person. He is not disillusioned by the fact of death, because what is death? Death is the separation of the relation between an Atma and an existing Sharira. Because the Atma is going to take up, it's due to take up a new Sharira. How can this be compared? Like in the same body, though we say same body, we have seen the previous lectures, the body is not the same. As I speak, I am changing. The body is changing. It's not the same. So, this is very minute change. But if you look at the gross changes, I was quite young sometime back as a baby, then as a youth, now as somebody, then maybe I am going to become old. Like there are various stages in a Sharira, but the Atma remains the same. In the same way, Dehantara Prapti, once this Sharira becomes unfit to use, because we saw in the earlier verse which can be put to use, now there is a stage where the Sharira cannot be used anymore. Then what happens is that the relation of Atma with the Sharira ends and it's due to take up a new Sharira. Just as a self associated with the body passes through childhood, youth and old age, so too at death it passes into another body. A wise man is not deluded by this fact. He is not deluded by this fact that, because I mean, we have to worry upon death. There is no need to worry upon death. So says Krishna. The teaching looks very impressive, but it's quite difficult to maintain it in our buddhi. You know, it is interesting to listen to these discourses, but we have to make abhyasa to remember it. Now, how does it happen? How does the jiva take up another sharira? What is the basis? Now, this is where we say karma. We bring in the concept of karma. Karma is a concept wherein it represents the results of all our past actions. If we keep doing good actions, then we accumulate good merit. If we keep doing bad actions, then we keep accumulating bad merits or demerits. But life is not only good or bad, it's a mixture of both good and bad. So which means karma is a mixed bag. We do not know whether the fruit that we are going to get is going to taste sweet or bitter or whatever. But anyway, we have to experience. We cannot throw away the fruit. We have to experience the fruit of karma. Now, when did I earn the first merit or demerit? Can we ask this question? When did I earn the first merit? Now, such a question is not answered. Such a question is not answered because karma is said to be anadi. Anadi means beginningless. Anadi means beginningless. Why? Because it is not that there is no beginning at all. It is not possible to find such a beginning. Because it's a numerous number of, cycles going back and forth, going forward. So it is not possible to find that moment when it all started. So it is said that karma is anadi. It is beginningless because its origin cannot be traced. It's a very important premise in the Indian schools of thought, like karma is being anadi. In fact, all the Astika schools of the Buddhism schools like Buddhism do accept the fact of karma, and it is anadi. Some people may ask, no, you tell me, I'm not convinced, you tell me the beginning of karma, then I'm willing to accept and then maybe I'll do something to address it. But it is like saying, going to a doctor, the doctor is willing to give you medicine for the disease. I keep arguing with him, no, you tell me how I acquired this disease. How did I get this disease? You tell me that. If that is convincing, then I'll take your medicine. Now the question is, you have to get cured now. If you're going to keep bothering about the disease, it's going to consume more. So generally this question is not entertained, and it is said that karma is anadi. Is it possible to break the shackles of karma? Yes, it is possible. That is why Gita Shastra is being given by Krishna. If we follow the teachings of Gita, then it is possible to break the shackles of karma. Karma Yoga, we are going to see in the coming lectures. Karma Yoga is doing an action for the sake of doing it as a duty and not having an eye on the result. Because I am going to do this activity, I am going to get this result. Or because I am going to do this duty, I am going to avoid something. If someone is going to do with this mentality, then that is not Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga is doing the karma for the sake of doing it as a duty. That we will see in the coming lectures. But let us understand karma more, aspects of karma more. Karma is said to be threefold: Sanchita Karma, Prarabdha Karma and Agami Karma. Sanchita Karma, Prarabdha Karma and Agami Karma. We can take the example of a farmer, an agriculturist, who is having a lot of seeds in his home. It's a big, huge vessel filled with seeds, which have to be planted. There's no option here, which have to be planted in his field. Every time he takes some seeds, say in a vessel, and then he is taking them to his field to sow them. And he works hard to take care of the field, and at a point the crops grow and again there are fresh seeds. Now there are seeds at three levels now. One is what is accumulated at home, which have to be planted, which have to be sown. There are some seeds in the bucket or in the vessel which have been taken already, and there are some seeds which have already reaped and they have to be brought back. Now this is Sanchita, Prarabdha and Agami. Nobody can measure the Sanchita Karma, because Sanchita is so huge that even Prarabdha is huge actually, because that vessel is a Prarabdha Karma which is already in function, which is already in use, that can lead to more than one birth. So one packet of Prarabdha Karma can lead to more than one birth. And whatever actions we do in this birth that we sow in the field, now the seeds, those are the results, are the Agami Karma. They have to be again poured into the Sanchita Karma package. So this is an example to understand the three divisions of karma, which means it is not easy to overcome the tendencies of karma. It requires strict disciplines like yoga to overcome the force of karma. Another example which I always think of is, we all have accounts in the bank. We have three kinds of deposits. One is the fixed deposit, other one is the current account or the savings account, and the third one is the recurring deposit. So the interest or the fixed deposit, it gets transferred to the savings account or current account. So that is what we withdraw. Because we don't break the fixed deposit, we make use of the amount in the savings account, we spend nicely. Then if there is a balance, we create a recurring deposit. Now once the recurring deposit matures, it is added to the fixed deposit. So it is, this chain is going on, that we keep accumulating our karma and then we keep reaping the results of the karma. Now this is about the threefold nature of karma. And this karma becomes a reason for the acquisition of the next birth. Because it is quite evident that we all have different kinds of sharira. Somebody has a fit sharira, somebody does not have a fit sharira. We all differ in terms of many complexities. Now the reason for those complexities is because of karma. So Krishna says, there is no need to worry because now the Atma is eternal. And the birth is acquisition of new body and death is dropping off the old body. Now, then what should we do with this body? It is okay that Atma is eternal, we get a new body, but what should we do with this body? Now, Krishna says, Matras Parshastha Kaunteya Shitoshta Sukha Dukkha Daha Agama Pajino Nityaha Tan Stitikshasva Bharata. Matras Parshastha Kaunteya Shita Ushna Sukha Dukha Daha Agama Pajino Nityaha Tan Stitikshasva Bharata. Bharata Kaunteya are the words used to address Arjuna. Krishna says, Arjuna, you have to make use of this body to do Karma Yoga. Or to yoga. Let us talk about today's this thing, to yoga. But doing yoga or doing Karma Yoga is not that easy because we have so many troubles. We have to bear so many things when doing yoga because there are so many difficulties when doing things. It is not, if it is quite easy, then everybody in the world would do yoga. Only a few of them are doing because it is not that easy. So which means you have to bear with the difficulties like happiness or unhappiness while doing your action. The moment you overcome either the happiness or the difficulty in the process, you are going to attain some maturity which will help you to overcome the process of rebirth. And these happiness or sadness or difficulties are agama payinaha. Agama payinaha means that they are temporary, they just come and go. Nothing is going to stay here for quite some time. They are going to keep changing. So titikshasva, titiksha means endurance. You have to learn to endure the difficulties as well as the happiness in life, because don't get lost in happiness. Don't jump in joy because you get some happiness, and don't fall down because you've got something to worry. You have to stay neutral and you have to bear with them. Now, what is this happiness and difficulty or the unhappiness thing about? The contact of senses with their objects is basically determines what is happiness and what is sadness. Heat is something which is afflicting us, right? Especially in some parts of the world, it's always hot. It's hot, hotter and hottest. The same heat which is afflicting the people over there is going to give comfort to people who are living in other parts of the world where it's going to be cold. There, people voluntarily go and approach heat. They burn some things in their home and then they keep warming them. Now, if the nature of heat is to only cause affliction, it should burn in everywhere. But it is not so. So, it also depends upon, it is not the mere contact of senses with the objects. It also depends on other conditions which gives rise to happiness and sadness. So they are mostly in the inner system and not entirely in the outer mechanism. So the contact of senses with their objects give rise to feelings of cold and heat, pleasure and pain. They come and go, never lasting mind. So they're not lost forever, they just come and go. So endure them. Krishna is telling Arjuna, you have to endure them, you have to learn to endure them, because you have to put the body to the best use possible so that you can break this bondage due to karma. We have to bear with them to dedicate our efforts for a chosen purpose. To live an ordinary life, to lead a life as it turns out, we may live like however we want to live. It does not make any sense. If there is happiness, we can enjoy. If there is sadness, we can try to escape. But if we take a purpose in life, if we take an aim in life and say that I want to do this, then the question of enduring difficulties makes more sense. So we have to endure the difficulties to accomplish the purpose, to accomplish the aim chosen in life. So Krishna advises Arjuna to be brave, a dhira. But who is a dhira? Says Kalidasa, he defines dhira. Kalidasa is a great poet in the Sanskrit world. He says, vikara hetau sati vikriyante yesham na chetansi te eva dhiraha. When there is an opportunity to fail, when there is an opportunity to fail, a person who does not fail, even when there is an opportunity, is called a brave person. To give an example, if I am going to say, I do not drink coffee, I have stopped drinking coffee, but until I smell coffee, the moment I smell coffee, I change my mind because coffee is already there, I want to drink it. No, I am not a dhira, because even if a coffee is brought to my nose, then I say, I'm sorry, I've stopped drinking coffee, I don't drink coffee. You should have a liking, and then you should, some people are there who do not like coffee, then that is not dhira. A person who has a liking for a coffee, who has already stopped drinking coffee, then coffee is being served to him, then he says, I'm sorry, I've stopped drinking coffee. Then that is bravery. Okay, there is a story which is told in the Zen school of philosophy. There are two Buddhist monks who are walking in a forest. They're both students of a teacher, they're both walking, and suddenly they come across a huge river. There's a lot of flood in the river, and they have to cross the river. In the meantime, a beautiful lady approaches these two monks, and she asks for help. Can you help me to cross the river? I do not know swimming and I'm afraid of the current of the river. We all know about the Buddhist monks. They're supposed to be monks, and they cannot have any attachment or engagement with any material things. Here, one of the students is very particular because his guru has told him, avoid women. So he says, sorry, I can't help. But the other monk is compassionate. He does not now look at the lady as a lady. In a sense, he sees in his mind that somebody is seeking help, so he has to help the lady. So what he does is, he carries the woman on his shoulder and they both cross the river. As they cross the river, the monk who carried the lady just helps her to get down and then bids goodbye, and then he walks as if nothing happened. Now the student who came along is not able to suppress his mind because he is agitated. He says, how can this fellow carry the lady? He is not supposed to do it. So he wants to ask this question to the person, to the other monk, why did you carry the lady? Now the other monk says, are you still carrying her? I dropped her long ago, it looks like you are still carrying her. So which means, when we don't have any attachment to the work that we do, then we can still be detached and then do without allowing our senses to dominate. So now that monk is a real dhira. He is so brave that he is not afraid that he will fail in the test, because he is quite brave. Whereas the other person is not so, and he is afraid. That's why he did not take up the opportunity to help. Now Krishna is telling Arjuna, titikshasva, you have to bear, you have to endure the difficulties, which is basically the contact of senses with the objects. Now Arjuna may ask, why should I become a dhira? Because Krishna is saying, this is to elevate yourself. Now he says, yamhi na vyathayantyethe purusham purushasabha sama dukkha sukam dhiram so mritatvaya kalpate saha amritatvaya kalpate. It is your choice, either you can endure or you can fall for the happiness and sadness. But bear in mind, if you are going to endure, you are going to elevate yourself. You are going to walk towards immortality. So he says, a person who is going to endure the happiness and the pain and pressure in his life to work for the purpose of life, then he is going to march towards immortality. Saha amritatvaya kalpate. For he whom these do not affect, pain and pleasure do not affect, O chief of men, that is Purusha Shabha, and to whom pain and pleasure are the same, that steadfast man alone is worthy of immortality. And he is going to attain immortality, and not a person who is going to fall for them. Now this is applicable to both Laukika and spiritual. Because we examples, like we see a lot of business people whom we say like living in a suitcase. We find a lot of people traveling across the globe. They also forego a lot of pain and pressure. But what is the reason there? The reason is to make money. Now even that is ignorance. It's not, Krishna is not talking of that. To have the jnana that Atma is eternal and the Sharira is not eternal, and to march in this way. So, but we can see that in world, even to attain material gains, one has to endure the pain and pressure. If it is true for even material gains, it need not be said that this is very much essential for the spiritual gain. So Krishna is saying, you have to endure pain and pleasure. In the next shloka, he says again, why the Sharira is not eternal and why the Atma is eternal. Nasato vidyate bhavo, na bhavo vidyate sataha, ubhayorapi drishtontaha, tvanayoho tattva darshibihi. Nasato vidyate bhavaha, na bhavo vidyate sataha, ubhayorapi drishtantaha, tvanayoho tattva darshibihi. The unreal can never come into being. Sat means real, asat means unreal. Na asataha vidyate bhavaha means the unreal can never come into being. Na abhavaha vidyate sataha, the real can never cease to exist. Ubhayorapi drishta antaha, the conclusion about these two is seen by the seers of truth. Tattva darshi means a seer, S-E-E-R, one has experienced the truth. Now Krishna says, the people who have experienced truth say like this. What they say is that which is asat does not have existence. That which is sat does not cease to exist. Now these words can be very confusing because this verse is being interpreted by different people in different ways. Because sat and asat. Sat means which is real. Asat means which is unreal. Now what is sat, what is asat, we have to be very clear. I have to mention about Advaita because only then we can appreciate what is Visistadvaita in a more clear manner. Now according to Advaita, sat is something which exists forever without changing. That which existed in the past, which is existing in the present, which will exist in the future without any change. If this is a criteria, then it is Brahman which is Sat. Because Brahman alone existed, it exists and it will continue to exist without any change. Now what about matter? If we say matter also existed, well, it has changed. Like the mud becomes a pot, now pot gets broken to go back to the state of mud. Which means it cannot be taken as Sat because it does not continue to exist in the same way. Even if you take it as existing, it is keeping on changing. Now, Sat, Asat. Sat is something which exists eternally. But Asat is something which is not eternal. So this is the thought of Advaita. But in Ramanuja school, like Atma, matter is also real. The matter will never cease to exist. It was there, it is there now, it will continue to exist. Now, how do we now understand bhava and abhava? Because now the shloka says, the unreal can never come into being. Now, I think here science is also helping us to understand. To say something as existing, if you want to point out something and say it is existing, it is. When we want to say it is, the moment we say it is not. Because things keep changing. Like I say, this is, if you want to say this is, the moment I say this is, it has already become this was. This has gone to the future as well. So this is the nature of matter. Ramanuja says, matter keeps changing so continuously that we it is called as asat. There is no moment that we can say to point out and say this is, because you know, the moment you say this is, it's already a different thing. So it is the nature of matter to keep on undergoing changes from one state to another. Whereas Atma is an unchanging principle. It is possible to point out, if it is possible to point out some Atma and say this is Atma, then this is eternal, because it was the same in the past, it is the same in the present, and it is the same in the future. Now, perishableness is the nature of matter. I think science also says, like energy cannot be created, cannot be destroyed. Matter cannot be created, cannot be destroyed. It is only transformed from one state to another. This is Visistadvaita according to me. This is what Ramanuja says. Matter is matter. Its nature is to keep on changing. Previously, what was mud, what was earth, has now become a pot. Now the nature of mud was different. The function of mud was different. It could not hold water. But now it has transformed to a pot. Now it has become harder and it can hold water now. If it's going to break, then it is going to go back to its, again, to the mud. Not in the same way, but again. So Ramanuja says, matter is called asat because it's going to keep on changing. That is its nature. It is perishable, whereas Atma is not a changing principle. Then don't we say we are in bondage, we are in, somebody is liberated, somebody is happy, somebody is sad and all these things. Then here, Ramanuja, what he does is, he says, there are two things to be understood in everything. One is Swarupa and Swabhava. Swarupa, Swabhava. Swarupa can be loosely translated as the nature or the form. Swabhava is a function. Swarupa can be loosely translated as the essential nature, and Swabhava as the function or the utility. For matter, for the Jagat or the essential principle, both Swarupa and Swabhava keep changing. The form and function of matter will keep on changing. There is no single moment where they both remain the same. Like it keeps on changing, transformation. But for the Atma does not undergo any change in its Swarupa. What is Atma Swarupa? It is Jnana Swarupa. It is Ananda Swarupa. There is no change in the essential nature of the Atma even during bonded state. That is why we are able to realize ourselves. Atma is known by the knower. It is not known as an object. When I say I know this body, then this body is known as an object of the sentence, I know this body. But I don't say I know my Atma. Because the I is, that explains Atma. That gives the experience of Atma. When you say I, that is the knowledge about Atma. You don't say my Atma, or this is my. Whereas the Sharira, you say this is my Sharira. So Sharira is understood as an object of knowledge, whereas Atma is subjective experience. Now Ramanuja says the nature of Atma, Jivatma, does not change at all. But what changes? The Swabhava changes. So which means, he says there are two kinds of knowledge that we possess. One knowledge is knowing the Swarupa, the Swarupa Jnana. The Swarupa Jnana of all the beings, of all the Atmas, in whichever bodies they are, is same. An ant also knows its presence. And elephant also knows his presence, and we also know our presence. Now this is Swarupa Jnana. Whichever Sharira we may take in the future, we will continue to know that I exist. But the Swabhava Jnana is used to know other things. Like if I'm sitting here and seeing you all, then I make use of the Swabhava Jnana to know you all. Whereas the Swarupa Jnana is used to know the Atma. The Atma is known, it is knowable on its own. Now the Swabhava Jnana of the Atmas keeps changing. That is why there is something called as bondage. When a person is liberated, then the Swabhava Jnana does not change at all. So both the Swarupa Jnana and the Swabhava Jnana do not change for a liberated person. Because liberation means there is no change, no bondage, no reason to worry. It is bliss. But in bondage, we are all different because of the change in the Swabhava Jnana. Some people are more intelligent, some people less intelligent, some people behave in a different way, some people are happy, some are unhappy. It is because of the change in the Swabhava Jnana. So again, to go back to the shloka, now the matter is here termed as asat because it undergoes transformation in both its Swarupa and Swabhava. The Jivatmas are unchanging in their Swarupa, in their essential nature, but they also undergo change in the Swabhava. Okay, now Krishna says, Ubhayorapi Drishtaha Antaha. This is the fixed knowledge about these two, about the Sat and Asat. Who says so? Krishna doesn't say, I say so. He says, people have already experienced this, they say, the seers say. It is said by the seers of truth that Atma is an unchanging principle and Sharira is a changing principle. So if you have a doubt in you that you are not going to fight, stating that all the people are going to be killed by you, then please be clear that you are only going to destroy the Sharira and not the Atma. And destroying the Sharira does not mean that they are going to die. They will only acquire a new Sharira. So what you're going to do, you're only going to end the link between this Sharira and the Atma. So don't be confused, because their Atma will continue to exist, if you have a doubt in this. So this is what Krishna is saying in the shloka, Na sato vidyate bhavo, na bhavo vidyate sataha, ubhayorapi drishtontaha, tvanayos tatra drashyabhihi. This interpretation is according to Ramanuja. Now, we will see the next shloka in the next lecture. Thank you.